There are two possibilities here. We're facing a mega crisis. One possibility is that we need to regroup and reboot. The other one is that somehow the trickle of spiritual teaching somehow will proliferate here in an effective manner. So I'm of the belief that we need to reboot culture. It's a mega crisis, meaning many crises converging and catalyzing one another into what's called a mega crisis or a perfect storm. But I could be wrong. I mean, these are the two possibilities. We see the proliferation of, for instance, Tibetan Buddhism going here and there, all sorts of little meetings, etc. So it's a sort of a grassroots sort of thing. It's been going on for quite some time. Zen Buddhism, non-dualism, New Thought, Course in Miracles. So we see that. Now, is that working? Is it working? This is the question. It's very difficult to determine this. One thing, I can say is that the principal defense, one of the principal defenses, is just to ignore, put those truth on ignore. Now, absurdity believes that if you just ignore whatever you're ignoring, that it doesn't exist. And if it doesn't exist, then how could you be ignoring it? How can you be ignoring something that doesn't exist? So this is this sort of self-referencing looping of absurdity, which is so difficult to cut through this. So whatever plan that I've been part of thinking this would work, which is just to... So this is a huge recognition this morning that absurdity ignores truth, puts it on ignore. And then it reasons, well, I don't see any truth. So how could I be ignoring it? If something doesn't exist, it's crazy. It's absurd to say I'm ignoring it. Wow, what a defense, huh? What a madcap defense that is. So, but this only works if truth is kept out of an absurdist society, civilization, culture. And this is what I call the mega crisis, is an attempt to eradicate any evidence, any strong evidence that absurdity isn't true, that there's something that is ignoring, okay? And this is what I see taking place in the world. Now, there are these proliferations of teachings, non-dual teachings, but it I don't know, it doesn't seem as quite as robust as it used to be. But maybe it's just, you know, gone underground and it's grassroots underground sort of thing. But culture and society in general, the trends I'm seeing are overwhelming that a mega crisis is coming. I could be wrong. So I'm reasonable saying I'm not able to assess the totality of the situation. So if it turns out that that all this grassroots non-dual effort is going to turn the tide in culture and society and bring us into a non-absurdist culture, that wonderful. But what I also have seen is that in order to cut through this ignoring, just a single isolated person like myself, doesn't work. I've tried it. It doesn't work. People have simply put me on ignore my entire life. Everyone just ignores me. I've got nowhere. So the idea of like embedding people, just one person here, one person there, and they're going to somehow help culture. I never had a voice. Nobody paid any attention to me. In fact, they studiously ignored me and I've gotten absolutely nowhere. So from that, I think that's a crazy notion to do it that way. And what I would say is you need like spirit, those who are helping do this need to have each other's back. And it needs to be a show of solidarity and strength that you can't, it's much more difficult to ignore that. There needs to, so, you know, you can't just have one solitary, isolated person trying to teach. Then you fall into all sorts of troubles, but mostly they're just completely ignored. This is a fundamental defense of absurdity. So that has to be accounted for. I haven't found it accounted for at all here. I've gotten absolutely nowhere. Now, lesson learned. I have to, if somebody says, oh yeah, that should work. No, it didn't work. You can't just go talk to a person. They're backed up. Culture backs them up. They're ignoring, backs them up entirely. You have this whole culture, civilization, world civilization, that everybody has each other's backs. This is what social media is such a problem, is everybody has each other's backs in terms of ignoring truth. And so all your friends will rush to your defense. So you know, theoretically you think, oh, social media, it's great. Everybody can have each other's backs with truth, but it's not working that way. It's the opposite. It's those people who are using it so much, those are the people who have an absurdist belief system, and they reinforce each other's beliefs of ignoring truth. And so you have upside down and backwards here. So it's, you know, a mega crisis, you might say, which means too much trouble, which means everyone, when there's a mega crisis anywhere, a mega crisis, everyone is within their rights, without having to explain themselves or their actions, to take refuge, the best refuge that they can take. And in a mega crisis, you cannot be held to explanation, because that delays you and busts your momentum up. You simply have to have the grace and say, look, do whatever you, and encourage everyone, do whatever you need to do to take refuge from this. I mean, it's a massacre is happening. You don't say, demand that somebody give detailed explanation when they're trying to flee a massacre, and say, well, I'm going to evaluate that, and I don't know if I'm giving you permission, and I don't know about that. That's ridiculous. It's absurdist. A massacre is happening. You encourage everyone to do everything they can to flee the safety. This is, I'm encouraging everyone, but nobody, you know, ignore. Culture of ignorance. And again, absurdity believes that by ignoring, there's logic, it says, that there's nothing there then. So it can't be ignoring. Well, I'm not ignoring anything. What are you talking about? There's nothing there to ignore. Well, of course, they've made massive efforts to repress all the evidence of what they're ignoring. Massive efforts. I will say, well, if there's nothing there to ignore, then why do you even try to repress? Have a culture that tries to suppress all this evidence? You should just allow everybody to do what they want to do. Oh, no. So, all the while, they have an entire culture which is based on ignorance and ignoring, and yet claim they're not doing any ignoring at all. You know, it's just utterly absurdist. So, how do you get past that? Well, you would need, I said a prayer this morning, I say, may I have the back of all bodhisattvas, sages, saviors, gurus, saints, etc. Call it bodhisattva is ideal of those who are absolutely compassionately dedicated to liberating everyone from absurdity. So may I have the back of all bodhisattvas, and may all bodhisattvas have my back. You've got to have the back. You've got to have a show that, look, we're in solidarity here. We're not separated. We're not isolated. When you put people like myself in isolation like this, that everybody says, well, you're isolated, you're being, so there's no one has your back. There's no show of solidarity. So you really think that people are going to go for that? No, those who are on the fence, teetering one way or the other, they need that. That's what culture is for. That's what civilization is for. Many are on the fence, and they're trying to get free of absurdity, and yet they're wavering on the fence, not sure which way to go. Those are the ones that help can help. Now, there are some who are just still rejecting truth and trying to embrace absurdity and you know, the miscreants, the stragglers. Well, they can't really be reached at this point. The problem is they're trying to reinforce their position by pulling everybody into absurdity with them. And so this is very harmful to those who are on the fence, who are wavering. So So civilization and culture, their aim has to be to help those who are wavering on the fence, to encourage them to get off the fence towards truth. And go towards truth. Reinforce, help them. They need help. It's very difficult. So when there's no help, then those on the fence, they just collapse. They go into absurdity, which is what has happened. So I've never experienced in my life any teacher that's in this world right now that I know of having my back at all. Not even one. No one. The only ones who have had my back are the bodhisattvas, the great teachers. But I've tried to, you know, encourage and praise. There's been a few minor ones who you might say who've encouraged me. They're not really known as teachers at all, but you know, more like isolated people struggling, and it's just been feeding and feeble. But I've tried to, you know, encourage. Say, yeah, keep going. This is great. But nothing. No response. No feedback. Anything. So it's like, wow, that, how do you succeed like that? You then people look at you and say, oh, you're isolated. You must be justified to put on ignore. Whereas if you have these convocations of many bodhisattvas coming together and holding these major empowerment festivals, etc., and there are hundreds of them, you know, coming, then the people who are on the fence say, wow, look at the solidarity they have here. Maybe I can be safe within, I can take safe harbor within this kind of solidarity. And when the absurdists try to cut them down, no, they all have each other's back and say, no way, we're not going to be cut down like that. And so it helps the people on the fence. So I believe you need a show of solidarity, strong solidarity, a true spiritual solidarity movement that helps those on the fence, because those on the fence will respond to that sort of thing. They don't have a strong enough will to just do it themselves in a situation of supreme isolation with nobody having their backs. I mean, even monasteries, everybody's got your back there. The entire structure, monastic structure, institutions, everything has your back. For me, I've never had anyone have my back, except the great teachers of the Holy Spirit. Very difficult. So I'm thinking we need to do a reboot and get as many bodhisattvas as possible and restart civilization, restart culture, and a restart would actually go much faster and be much more beneficial than trying to deal with this train wreck right now. I could be wrong about this. Maybe all of this effort is working beautifully and it's all smoothly sailing into a new world order of spiritual. You know, I see it as kind of like, you know, it's a sort of a new culture, sort of taking the best of all the great traditions. Judaism, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Christianity, along with, you know, some others. Taking the best of all of that and not saying that one should dominate this or that or anything, but just extracting the best and then producing a new culture. Like the culture, Tibetan Buddhism is very, very good culture in terms of spiritual success. They've had tremendous success. So you have to learn from that. Why do they have so much success? You take the best and then you present that through a massive showing of solidarity with the bodhisattvas, massive amount of miracles, and you help the people who are wavering to realize, okay, this, I can go this way, and I will get some help. It's a daunting task to cut through the knot of absurdity. It seems overwhelmingly difficult because, again, absurdity is so absurd, it just says, well, if I put something on ignore, then it doesn't exist, therefore I'm not ignoring. So there's nothing to... I don't have any problem at all. Okay. Very good. Absurdity wants to have its own culture, own world, own everything. right? And this is what this world is all about. And yet, we also have second thoughts about it. So, hey, wait a minute. This is, you know, not so sure about this. Let me. I think I don't want to get. I want to get free of it. Help. That's what the great helpers, the bodhisattvas, the sages, the gurus, saints, etc. That's where they come into the picture. The grace of God, the Holy Spirit, comes into the picture to help us. But otherwise, we simply remain trapped, as it were, mentally trapped in absurdity. Even though it's just mere pretense, it's quite difficult to see that when you believe that you're not ignoring anything, that you're seeing all the facts. And then from those facts that you're seeing, which are based on massive ignoring, you conclude, oh, there is no escape. So really, it requires as big an effort as possible, through and through, culturally, institutions having your back, helping you out with this. It is such a sticky problem, difficult problem, with the continuity fear continually rebinding us to it. Such an endeavor to get free of it, to realize that you don't need any merit to be what you are. To be perfect. You don't require to upgrade what you are. You don't require to maintain what you are. You're not required to improve what you are. Zero requirement for merit from God's side. Zero. Now again, everybody can hear this and they can resonate with them, but they say, yeah, but how do I extend this in this culture? I mean, wow, it's just, the culture is so absurdist. So again, mega crisis coming. Mega crisis coming. And we're within our rights, completely within our rights, for everyone to flee such a massacre and take the best safe harbor they can find. Now, some will find better safe harbors than others, but so I encourage everybody to find the highest safe harbor that they can find. The highest harbor, safe harbor they can find. The very best. And I wish this upon everyone. I pray that everyone find the highest harbor, safe harbor, from the mega crisis. From absurdity, trying to feel right about itself. Because, of course, absurdity is just a mental projection. We're playing with it, so we want to feel right about ourselves. But we think absurdity is some sort of autonomous thing that has to feel. We're not aware it's us that want to feel right about ourselves. So we have the juice, the creative juice, to push this absurdity to where absurdity tries all out to feel right about itself. Then you have a mega crisis. A mega crisis. So we have to commit to the Pure Lands. Commit to the Pure Lands, or safe harbor. Commit to safe harborage. Commit to safe harborage. The highest you could find, and encourage everybody to find the best they can find. Flee from a massacre. Take refuge where you can. Now, I want to be where there's great teachers there, okay, who can help us with our clarity, cut through the knot of absurdity, so we can be more helpful to others. So, safe harborage in a place where there's great teachers, they have your back. This is very helpful. How about in a world that has your back? A world that, without forcing issue, it has your back, supporting your belief that truth is true and nothing else is true, and that we're absolutely free, and we need no merit whatsoever for this freedom. Freedom is not something we attain through merit. It is something we were created as free. And for a world that has your back like this, that's a very good safe harbor. But all of this, of course, is utterly lost on absurdity. And you can, it's in one ear and out the other. In an absurdist culture, there's no support for this belief. So you can hear it and say, yeah, I like the words you're saying. But then it just drop it. You say, I can't pick that up. I can't pick it up. So yeah, it's light, it's not so heavy, but I can't carry that. The culture demands we put it down and ignore it. And says the culture says the only way you're ever going to be feel right about yourself is to ignore truth. That's absurdity. Absurdity says the only way you will ever feel right about yourself is to ignore truth. And to no one's surprise, that doesn't work. Because we are created as truth. We are truth. How can truth feel right about itself when it's trying to deny itself? It can't. It cannot. It can only feel this sense of something isn't right. I don't like this. Fear, confusion, all this. So absurdity doesn't work. And a culture based on absurdity, we're not well served by it at all. Not well served by it at all. So sometimes a computer, you got to reboot it. And sometimes a civilization, you need to reboot it. And all the traditions, you know, they're based on what works. Practical, what works. And it's so easy to restart something like that and make it better than ever. It's not like the great ones are ignorant of how to teach properly and what's effective. Of course they know. Of course the grace of God, Holy Spirit, knows what's effective and how we can be helped. It's not a problem. Ultimately, what we get trapped into here when we come into this world, even to try and help, is we get trapped into practice, effort, which is belief in merit. This is the flip side. There's two things. Is we need to listen to the wisdom of the elders in terms of repentance. And also, we need to also be aware that no practice, no merit, etc. is the truth. And therefore, we don't need to accumulate any merit in life. So we can come into this world enlightened and stay that way. So there's both of that, both of those. For most, we need to pay attention to the accumulated wisdom of discipline. So the discipline of mind and habits, cultural habits, so we build up the necessary acuity of clarity. We evaporate our continuity fear, which enables clarity to shine ever more clearly. So ultimately, clarity can see, oh, I don't need to practice at all. All practice is based on the belief in merit, which is totally false. At that point, you cut through the whole knot of absurdity and get liberated. So we need to practice to realize we don't need to practice, is one way of putting it. So it's thinning out practice. And finally, we have the clarity to see, oh, there's no such thing as merit. I can never gain even the slightest bit of merit through any practice. Even abiding in the now doesn't give me any merit. Even abidance doesn't give us the slightest bit of merit. So may all the great enlightened ones, may they all appear to us, continuously appear to us. May our day be full of their appearancing and grace, absolutely full of it. Because there really is a goal. There really is a realization. We really can be liberated. So even abidance in the now, in no effort, in no practice. Abidance in that, even that doesn't give us the slightest bit of merit. this is a kind of like shock, that a wow shock. I feel like you're pinned against the seat. This is how I feel now. That's good. You kind of feel like you're like some sort of G-shock force is hitting you and just pins you against the seat. Just, oh, wow. That's really great. That's really great. It's not merit, right? But it's clarity. And even the highest clarity does not give us the slightest trace of merit. There is not even a trace of merit anywhere in reality. Hallelujah. All praise to the great teachers, liberated teachers who have helped us recognize this. So in a culture that's helpful, full stop in the wow, where the culture, we say we're walking together in the wow, the entire culture. And what are we doing? We're learning to manage our success on the spiritual path. As we thin out the continuity fear, evaporate and thin it out, get closer and closer and closer to recognition that there's not a trace of merit anywhere in reality, anywhere at all, actually. Not even a trace. All of the prayers, the mantras, everything that's ever been done has not even left the slightest trace of merit anywhere. There is no trace. So there's no merit to find. So the mind is free of searching. Hallelujah. One of the keys to managing success on the spiritual path is to get back on the horse every day. And is to go at it again the next day. For example, I had such a tremendous wow yesterday that I struggled. In the evening time, I didn't know what to do with myself. Wow. Started listening to music and this kind of stuff. I said, it's not good. Getting pulled down into that. And this morning, I couldn't sleep. I was kind of agitated and shocked. Just the wow so strong. And I was thinking, how do I pull out of this? I couldn't quite find a way. So I started applying a few techniques and say, you know, whatever temptations I have, I'll deal with those in another life, if at all. But for the rest of this life, no, that's for another life. And I pushed it into another life like that, a potential life. Maybe later, not now, maybe later. It's just certain techniques that are very helpful. But the most helpful one is to get right back into full-on clarity mode like this, going further, get on the horse and go further. So, this is, you know, indispensable aspect of managing our success is to go further. Because this proves to us, it shows us, oh, I'm not stuck. I can still function and clarify and all that. So we cannot just get stuck in the wow either. At some point, we pick it up and go further. But we have to be very aware of the wow, which it seems like we're floundering. And it's not, we're just in temporary shock of our success. You know, the success I had yesterday was so extreme that it was shocking. But that's required right now. We have to have tremendous success. So managing it is difficult. But just pick right up, confident. Go on to the next hole. It's like golf. I've never had a hole in one. If you get a hole in one, what do? Well, you get your ball out of the cup and go to the next tee, right? And just keep playing, and that helps smooth it out. Helps smooth it out. It's a good metaphor. You got to go to the next hole, and that has its challenges too. And that helps erase any thoughts of the previous hole. No matter how well you did, if you did, as you say, you played it beautifully. I played the 17th just beautifully. I just ripped a perfect drive, long and perfect. That hit a really good four metal. And was left with a tricky shot, about 80 plus yards, let's say. Uphill, though, I knew it would play longer, so I took a 50-degree wedge and hit it beautifully. Hit it hard, hit it beautifully. And went up there, it's like 6 feet from the pin. Just, the pin was hidden. You couldn't see exactly where it landed. But it was just a gorgeous shot. So three gorgeous shots. And then I just calmly rolled the putt in for birdie. So nice. Went over, picked it up, went to the next hole. But it's really, really great when you can play four great shots on a hole, on a par five. Four great shots. And you get rewarded like that. But then there's the next hole, and you just you can't be thinking about it. You can't be taking one hole to the next hole too much. You cannot. And the course doesn't stop just because you played a really good hole. That it doesn't stop that way. And the previous couple, same thing. I mean, it's just starting with 13, 14, and 15. Just played them beautifully. 13 is just a brutally difficult hole. And I just smashed the four wood, right in the middle of the green. And the putt almost went in and just hung on the lip, just tapped it in. Easy par. That hole is just extremely difficult. That was like easy. And the next hole, again, one great shot, two, three great shots. Great chip shot, right, almost went in, just tapped it, easy par. Next one, great drive, great approach shot. Just missed the birdie, but tap in for par. Just smooth, sailing along like this, Well, still you gotta go to the next hole. So no matter how well we do each day of the spiritual path, the next day is like, it's the next hole. Okay, so I gotta play this hole. So that gathers our attention and our focus and our determination. You have to go at it again. Every day is a new golf hole, a new spiritual hole that we have to play. Got to hit that fairway. Got to find a way to finish this hole too. So be confident, smooth, confident. Don't go rummaging for your ball. Don't go struggling in your thoughts. Don't struggle. Whatever you do, don't struggle for merit. Don't struggle. Get the insight and then don't struggle. Don't allow the struggle to arise. You had the insight. You saw it clearly. What is there to struggle about? Refuse to struggle. Don't even struggle trying to refuse to struggle. Neither one of those. Just a full stop in the wow. Allow yourself to feel the wow. Don't try to get rid of it. You see, when we struggle trying to get rid of struggle, or not struggling, we're trying to get rid of the wow. Say, I don't even have the wow. No, we will have the wow. So you have to allow that level of shock to be there. This is the key. Do not make the mistake of trying to eradicate that, because then you will struggle mightily and you get sucked into the struggle. Acknowledge the continuity fear, the shock of getting past it, of thinning it out. Wow, I just thinned it out a lot. Wow. And then realize this is going to generalize throughout your whole belief system, the whole landscape. You'll never be the same. This is the wow. I will never be the same. When you really see that you can do it better, that there's some perspective that is way better, and you see it, and you know it's true. this changes your life. Unalterably, your perspective has changed, and the entire landscape of your perspective is going to be affected by that. So don't measure. Don't try to define. Don't box it in. Don't try to describe it too much. You could just relay the wow once you get there. But don't try to necessarily go back and do it again. No, one, it's been done already. It's already done. It's already done. And this is what the great teachers help us with, especially their close students, is that the teacher has this assurance that, yeah, absolutely you saw it correctly. And you've already seen it. It's already done. The seeing is it. Now you have to just then, you know, don't struggle with it. Have faith. Have faith. Have faith. Have faith. And this is vastly helpful. And so the whole culture, many teachers, then the whole culture takes on a sort of a faith that this, yes, this goal is possible. Yes, we don't need to, don't struggle, just full stop in the wow. And the momentum becomes tremendous. Pounce on truth before absurdity pounces on you. Ever had those days or hours where you get all the stuff done, you procrastinate on all this little stuff you don't want to spend the time on, and it's tricky, and you let it go for a year, you know, things get worse. I just did like five of those, boom, 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 like that. Feels really good. Fixed a lot of little nagging stuff that was really starting to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. So sometimes we have to do that. And it just pounced on it. Pounce on truth the same way. Be alert for it. Brisk. The problem we have in this world, we don't manage our success properly, so we spin our wheels, we get lethargy, we get dull, we're not really, you know, we feel maybe when we die, you know, we'll get some reward. And you can never put the reward after you die. Never do that, okay? That's bogus. That is very bogus. Say you got to get it while you live here. As soon as you put the reward, when you die, lethargy starts to set in. Because, you say, nobody will know if I don't make it. Who will know here? Nobody will know here that I took it easy, I was lazy, because the reward's after you die. That's the worst thing to say, that the reward comes after you die. That's when the reward comes to you. You talk about undermining your spiritual path. That will really, really do it. Now, I know that after you die, if you have not freed yourself from absurdity, you will come back here. You will come back here. And if you're not in abidance, if you've not freed yourself from the entire absurdist belief system, including any belief in merit whatsoever, when you come back here, you will get sucked into it again. This is true. So, don't ever think that death brings you some liberation. It doesn't bring you the liberation that is truly required. So we never say, oh yeah, after I die, you know, I'm going to go to heaven and stuff. No. You go to heaven when you free yourself from the absurdist belief system, which comes from the mind, not from the body. And the mind continues on after the death of the body. And belief in the mind, mind continues to project and continues to believe and continues with absurdity. It hasn't liberated itself from absurdity. after the death of the body, after the birth of a new body, after the death of that body, on and on and on and on and on like that. So we are not saying anything about that death liberates us, or even worry, and not even focused on what happens after death at all, really. We mentioned it that you know, you come back here is what happens if you're not liberated. You come back to some, you remain within the absurdist belief system and everything that puts you through, which it puts you through hell, is what it puts you through. Okay. We don't have to delineate any of the specifics of this world or that world or how this or that. It puts us through hell, period. Keel hauls us through hell. Absurdist belief system. Always has, always will. There is no way out of, no way around that. We have to then drop the absurdist belief system. It's the only way out. It's the only way out. And that's not something that's decided for us by death. Some force outside of our mind intervenes in our mind. Our mind is the one mind. There is no force outside of the one mind. There's nothing outside of the one mind that can intervene at all. Now, is it possible in the after the body dies, it dies? Is it possible that you can liberate yourself in the afterlife? Yes, that's possible, absolutely, because you're still stuck in absurdity. So you will keep working on it. And yes, you can do that. But there's nothing intrinsic in death at all that is going to liberate anyone. So I'm waiting to get the oil change. I go in the waiting room, and of course there's television on there, the news, blah, blah, all this. I say, I'm not staying out here. I go outside. I'm boycotting the television, boycotting news. And there's these women in there waiting, and of course they're on their smartphones, as always, boycotting, boycott smartphones. Boycott women, actually. Boycott the world. It's interesting that in absurdist belief system, male and female bodies arise. Male and female bodies. They're both completely part of the absurdist belief system. But the female role is way more important, essential to absurdity, because it produces more flesh. That's why. So the best role for anyone in this world is as a renunciate. That is very true. Very true. It seems like women and children are transfixed by the smartphones. It's just extraordinary. I hardly see anymore. Any time a woman sits down in a waiting room anywhere, she's immediately on a smartphone and just absolutely going like it's the most important thing in the world. In terms of, you know, sitting down and do I just have this sort of a overall social awareness around me? Do I smile? Say, hello, how are you doing? Let's talk about truth or something. Or no, immediate fixation on smartphones, which of course gets passed on to the children, doesn't it? So, you know, you could say that women have gone bad. I say that. They've made all sorts of deals that they're not telling anyone about. And it is interesting today also that I, you know, they'll say it's a woman's prerogative to change her mind. Well, that means to make false promises, right? So I promise this, promise this, promise this. Oh, you know what? Later on, I changed my mind. So what's men's prerogative to escape from women, maybe? I would say so. And it's just like, wow, this world, you know, this doesn't have to. We could renounce the world. Being a renunciate doesn't mean that you automatically succeed, but it gives you the best opportunity to succeed, I would say. It gives you the best opportunity to develop the kind of clarity that we need to cut through this horrible knot of absurdity. And we're spirit. We're not either male or female, so we can do it. We need the habits of clarity, and we cannot, and we have to be very industrious and brisk about this. And the problem in the world is when you're very, very brisk, very intense, a lot of energy focused, the world sees that. The women see that, the men see that, and they say, hey, if this someone can work for me, I could make, they can help make my life very comfortable, right? I mean, look at their world beaters. I mean, how they get after it like that. So what happens is your efforts get usurped here in this world. Okay, this is why monastic renunciation is so important, some sort of renunciation, so you do not get usurped, that you're the greatness of spirit that you have, determination that you have, is not taken and used to enrich some materialistic enterprise here to make, you know, pamper people, make them more comfortable, make them more beautiful, yard more beautiful. This, they will simply use all your energy and enslave you, working on making their lives more comfortable and being pampered. That's it. Instead of using that industry and energy and briskness and determination to develop the right kind of clarity, get the right kind of clarity to cut through the knot of absurdity. Truck show, cut through the knot of absurdity. This is what we all have to do. And so that's why materialist anxiety is so terrible. So terrible. It's just everyone is expected that this is going to be your life, serving this beast. And in no way should it be that way. In no way should it be that way. So, unfortunately, this sort of civilization, you know, you have to work, you know, double time. You have to please materiality at some point, and also develop the clarity. So it's very, very challenging. And when the women go materialistic, which they have a very strong tendency to do, because they want a surplus, and they want the children, for the children, they want to be taken care of, they want to be comfortable. It's what happens is they will get you to do this, get you to do this, get you to do this, get you to this, and just absolutely, the more you do, the more they want you to do, materialistically wise. And you know, in like spiritual cultures, the man is allowed to meditate for 4 or 5 hours a day. That's perfectly acceptable, if not more. He's allowed to go to religious festivals. He's allowed to do this or that. And so they don't prosper materially to a large extent. The household doesn't, but they prosper spiritually, which is way more important. Way more important. But in this materialistic world, now you don't get a minute for meditation in most places, right? Most households. I do. I insist upon it. I just basically don't tell you what I'm doing. I just disappear. I just, you know, I use my will to do it. But it's brutally difficult in this world. Because there's a honey-do list. There's list. Hey, do this. You need to do this. Oh, well, y'all got so many things for you to do. You know, keep maintenance. Make my materialistic world more comfortable for me. Make absurdity work for me. Make me content with absurdity. Say, oh, I'm only asking you just one thing. Make me content with absurdity. Okay, make this absurdist belief system, make me content within that framework. It's only one thing they're asking, right? Of course, it's impossible. So, you know, it's a question of discerning between I'm only asking to do one thing and it's impossible. So is that asking one thing, or is it asking infinite efforts, all of which lead to even more infinite efforts, because the goal is impossible? So the world lacks this type of discernment. It lacks this type of discernment that I'm sharing here. It simply lacks it. And you cannot succeed if you don't have this type of discernment. It's impossible. You cannot. You don't know how to choose. You will be conflicted and frightened. For 1 minute, maybe you choose truth. The next moment, you choose absurdity. Like that. You cannot abide. And then you think that abidance is then to combine the two. So when you can't abide you can't discern clearly, then you think that the solution is to combine the two. And when you try to do that, you get mental chaos. And then that freaks you out, and then you say, wow, I don't know what to do. And then you say, boy, I really need help. This is really too much. And then the Holy Spirit will show up and help you out. Or if you turn to materialism, then you will be enslaved by it severely. Such is the nature of this situation here. Mark my words on this. Now, you bring your vehicle in for oil change. They say, oh, you need this. And, you know, it's like four or five things. Right? And one of them is a light bulb. And the light bulbs keep burning out in these new vehicles. And I asked the guy, I said, hey, look, I mean, you know, what's going on? They said, yeah, we know about it. Everyone's lights are burning out. I said, why? He said, what do you mean why? So they can make more money. That's why. I said, what's wrong with the light bulb? They make them cheaper. They make them so they break. I mean, back in the old days, the days of yore, you know, back when they made light bulbs that didn't burn out. I mean, light bulbs rarely burn down on a car. Rarely. I mean, 15 years or more. I mean, now, like about a year. Year, lights are continuously burning out. I have to carry a bunch of spare light bulbs with me because, you know, every few months someone says, oh, do you know this, your light's out? And this, you know, there's how many lights are? 1, 2, 3, you know, running lights, but maybe it's like 8 to 10 lights or something. One of them's always burning out. And you see these people with one headlight now all the time. People's running lights are out. It's throughout the industry, throughout the world. And the guys, the mechanics, they're making the bulbs cheap. They're making them so they fail, so they can what? Sell more bulbs. And this is, everything is this way. Intentionally is engineered to fail so that you have to buy another one. This is the paradigm, that the materialistic paradigm that we're in. I mean, how terrible is that? I'm sitting here on a bench staring at this shrub, and half of it's dead. Actually, about three quarters of it's dead. There's still a little bit of greenery, but you know what? The rest of this plant is going to die too. As Jesus said, this world is nothing but, nothing more, nothing less than a reflection in our mind, the one mind, of our desire to pretend that freedom doesn't exist. That's it. Our desire to pretend that freedom does not exist. Now, in times gone by, when the institutions of renunciation were more in charge, and we were able to focus better on spiritual truth, you had everything was marked, you know, publicly with a cross or symbol, you know, a symbol, trident, but, you know, the very symbols of the religions, a spoked wheel, Buddhism, whatever. Those were the public buildings, the benches, you know, everything had those markings on just to remind everybody, to keep your attention, like, hey, yeah, this is our culture, this is important. This is our culture, this is important. And that's super helpful. You just look around, you glance, and you're reminded wherever you look. Oh yeah, okay, this is what I'm here for. This I need to focus in. Oh yeah, and so these reminders are very helpful. But what's happened here in the United States, for example, is they're trying to get rid of every single public display of religion everywhere, and you almost never see anything now. I'm looking around. Where do I see any indication that this is that this culture is focused on cutting through the knot of absurdity? Nowhere. Get rid of the crosses off the hills. They used to put crosses on the mountains and the hills. Get rid of them in school. Okay, no public displays of religion anywhere. On and on and on. This is disastrous. So it's super important that there be public displays prominently all over. What this culture stands for, the high ideals of this culture. What are the high ideals of this culture? That should be made apparent to everyone, all over. And these days, you basically never see anything except stuff, right? Material things. What are the high spiritual ideals that this culture stands for? And most people wouldn't have a clue. I bet you I ask most people, to what do you think? I don't know. Well, if you don't stand for cutting through the knot of absurdity, you stand for absurdity. Okay? By default, this is a fact. This is a fact. So this culture stands for absurdity right now. Condemned. Jesus said, I didn't come to save the world, I came to condemn it.
very important.
So I'm just sitting here on the street, and I'm noticing a couple things I've noticed. I've seen two men, not together, but one and then another, walking, and they're carrying, like, a sleeping bag, a backpack. I mean, it seems like they're just traveling, you know, walking. They don't have a house. They don't have a place. They just carry their home on their back. One of them had this foam roll. I think you lie on that foam roll, and then I think inside it there might have been some type of sleeping bag, and they had a water bottle and a pack. And somebody just walked with a wooden staff, and he used that to skewer, go through the middle of a sleeping bag, and carry it that way, plus a backpack. Okay, about the only thing you see in this society now is those little stickers on cars, those little aluminum things with a fish, you know, for being a Christian, fish. But you see now way more of these fishes with Darwin on them or something like that, you know, just to try to refute, you know, Christianity and assert absurdism. Because, you know, a religion, you lead a horse to water, you can't make him drink. And a religion tries to give us the opportunity to support us in our high endeavor of developing the necessary clarity to cut through the knot of absurdity. But it doesn't mean we're going to do it for sure. It doesn't guarantee it that you know, we have to be willing to do it ourselves. We have to be willing to do it. And so if we become unwilling to do it, then they blame, we absurdly blame religion for it. It's religion's fault. That's why I didn't do it. That's nonsense. If you really want to do it, there's nothing that's going to stop you. Of course, if there's not a supportive structure culturally, it becomes quite difficult, but it's still doable. Actually, you know the most prevalent symbol of our society right now? Dogs. That's right, dogs. Now, you go in any store, there's dogs wandering around. And so what's dog? The opposite of God. Reverse the term G-O-D, you get D-O-G. So it's a very interesting symbol of absurdity, flipping our intentions upside down and identifying with what we call animal nature instead of what we truly are, which is really absurdity. To identify with animal nature is absurdity. It's not what we are. What we are is non-absurdity, truth. You know, in some places, the cars, the jeeps, the trucks, the public transportation, all have religious icons, names, statues, little shrines. Everything is plastered with reminders of what's important. Not here. It's against the law. I mean, they've passed every law, and they're just beginning. They're going to pass laws that just absolutely forbid it. It's an absurdist culture. It is absurdity that tries to crucify truth here, of course. And then the fronts for absurdity bodies, you know, appear to be doing the dirty work. But it's really the mind, the absurdist belief system that is trying to crucify truth. But, you know, what is fronting for materialism now? What's fronting for? What's the key? Well, in my life, you know, you'd say that women crucified me. They're the ones that have crucified me in my life. Absolutely. The men have just, whatever they did was at the behest of women, trying to please them. Are afraid not to do it, you know, do the dirty work. But they were working for the women. There's no question about it. No question about it, as a matter of fact. So, right now we need to be protected from women. There's no question about that either. They will absolutely crucify truth right now. Because they're drunk. The Bible says the whores of Babylon will be drunk on the blood of the saints. Well, this is the situation now. There's no question about it. So it's important to bring this out in the open. And this is a truism again. And that there are, of course, exceptions to this. But it most certainly is a truism. It marks the spirit of the age, of this age, that women are very, very militant in crucifying truth here. Truth to be said, they always have been. But of course, none of us are women. None of us are men either. These are dream figures. Okay. That's all they are. They have absolutely no relevance to what we really are at all. None. Nothing. Zero. But in terms of the dream and keeping the dream alive, we would play a central role, very, very central role to it. In the dream, producing flesh, raising the new generation. I mean, you know, there's three things that have to happen to help. There has to be religious institutions that teach the truth. Okay, they emphasize the truth, that this is an absurdist dream that we're entertaining, and it's a reflection in our mind of an absurdist dream of pretending that we got rid of freedom, that our freedom doesn't exist. There has to be right religious teaching. There has to be the women, the mothers have to bring their children to these churches, these places of instruction, religious instruction. And they have to insist that the children from earliest age attend these and pay attention and meet the standards that are set. And they have to be very strict about it with their children. And three, the man has to back the woman up on this, okay? The husband has to back the wife up. Now, if the wife doesn't want to bring the children, then the man has to have the authority to insist upon it, which produces friction in the house, it is true. But still, if the man, male has authority, says, this is what you must do, you must bring the children here to church, they must pass, and the woman, and if the men have the authority, the women cannot provide too much backlash to that, then that too can work. But ideally, you have three things aligned. You have the institutions that teach truth, the mothers that insist their children attend these institutions, and the husbands that back this up, back it up 100%. No wiggle room on this. This is what works. Jesus was born into Judea. And the Jews had a long tradition. They were very strict. And the mothers insisted their children attend these religious institutions, get right religious instruction. And the husbands backed them up. And the situation was set up so that the children got a very strict, severe, thorough religious education. And this enabled the Jewish people to free up some of their attention for clarity. Now, you can do two things with clarity. This is important. You can either use it to liberate yourself from absurdity, or you can use it to control others. Okay, those are the two options. So, cultures that have liberated some of their clarity, it doesn't automatically mean that they're going to use it in the right way. Some will, some won't. But it behooves everybody on the planet to have this right religious education, because if they do, then they cannot be controlled by those who choose to use their clarity to manipulate and control others. And part of what we have, one of the trends, there's many trends in this world, crisis trends. One of them is the world is being manipulated and influenced and controlled by those who did develop some clarity and decided, hey, you know, I could use this to be superior and control others and manipulate and get rich and set up all these systems of usury and gambling and materialism and become fabulously powerful in the world and have everybody dependent on me and, you know, on and on. It can be used that way, and has been in this world, actually, by people from all races, all religious backgrounds, etc. It's not just a Jewish issue. It's everybody's issue here. This is what can happen. You know, you can say it's the, you know, Anglo-American problem, the Jewish problem. You could say it's the Chinese problem, and you know, you could name lots of names in terms of powerful manipulative interests. They call it the New World Order. They call it, you know, these Illuminati. They call it all that. Well, yeah, I mean, you get these various, you know, you could say the Vatican thing, it's the aristocratic families of Europe, you know, you could go on and on, is they had the advantages and the strictness, etc., but they didn't use it in the right way. And this is a great failing. And it's pointed out that when you become knowledgeable, when you liberate some of your awareness from absurdity, you reinvest that in the path. You don't say, "Oh, wow, now I'm smarter than everybody. I can see, you know, how to psychologically manipulate them." That's a dodo, okay? That means they didn't have a thorough enough education. It wasn't grounded in the morals and ethics too, and humility. So this world has failed on so many fronts, but these failures are not unique to this world. These are basic failures. And we just have to correct our mistakes. But these days we have no institutions that are hardly any institutions really that are really teaching the truth. Okay. Failure on that account, big failure. We have mothers, you know, not taking their children, not being strict, not insisting on all this, because they would get in trouble. Social services take their children away if they're trying to be too strict, and then fathers have no authority anymore over the children or mothers at all. Their wives none. So you have all three of these important factors are fail at this point. Fail. And this is another disastrous trend, along with all the others. They're all these disastrous trends are all coming together, converging, and going to catalyze one another. And that's where you have a mega crisis. In pagan absurdist societies, women rule the roost. It's a matriarchal, goddess-worshipping complex. And the men just make sure that they do, please, you know, the matriarchy. That simple. In religious societies, it's not quite like that. There's those who have followed the grace of God and reached enlightenment, reached liberation, who are very learned about this. Those are the ones who have some authority in such societies. Judaism would be like the rabbi, for instance. Someone who's done a profound amount of work and study. And in fact, the women of Judaism insisted that the men, that they wanted to have someone in each family, the male, study, specialize in studying. They insisted on it. They raised their children that way. You got to do this. Now, they may have had mixed motives, right? Because they became smarter than most others, which could be used to then acquire massive power and wealth, which would be the women get incredible pampering, okay? So that certainly was motive in some cases, probably not all, right? So you have to, you know, it's got to be, the men have to have some authority too. And men tend to be less interested in pampering and vanity and comfort. So they say, forget about how I look. Keep studying, keep working, find the truth, specialize, get it done. You got to be an expert. I never look at my skin, you know. I'm not even aware of my skin hardly. Comb the hair so it's not, you know, completely terrible. And that's it. Pretty much so. I mean, in terms of how the body. Forget about how the body looks. Forget about this. We're not running a beauty contest here. We're trying to ascertain the will of God. So we've gone back to a pagan society. There's no question about it. And the women would absolutely rule the roost. You could tell the attitudes of someone who's in charge, the swagger, the confidence. And it's on women now. They're the ones who have the swagger, because the law now has been changed to back them up. And their parents now are empowering the daughters to be in charge, to tell everybody what to do. This is automatically what happens when we turn away from non-absurdity and go back to absurdity. Automatically, this is what happens. So in the cultures that valued wisdom, both men and women had strong roles to play. And it's not like males having power over women. It's set up so those who have like the grace of God and ascertain the will of God, they're the ones who have the power. It's not just because they're a man or just because they're a woman. Women can have power in those situations. Absolutely. But they're also wise and understand the nature of absurdity, how it tries to put women in charge so that the women will send their children to absurdist education. You see why women are pivotal is because the influence they have on the children and their grandchildren and their great-grandchildren. So it's absolutely pivotal. And the women are the ones who spend the time educating with the children, helping them pattern their attention habits, okay? So they're central to the habits of attention. And how they decide, so goes the culture. Ultimately, you know, in a couple generations, the whole thing can come down, which is what has happened. Mothers now send their kids to the movies. They say, watch the television. Here's a tablet. Play these computer games. They maybe never say a word about a strict religious education, very important education, of bringing the children up into a sense of high responsibility, high endeavor, high challenge, high seriousness, high determination, and tell them what the outcome is, the positive outcome. Where are the saints? The mothers can point to the child of the saints, say, look, I want you to be like this saint. It used to be that way. There were quite a few saints around the world, actually, in all traditions. And mothers would take these children to the saints, say, look, this saint is a great saint. You know, look at the miracles this saint has done. This is a holy person. And I want you to be like them. So this is why I'm taking you to religious education. I want you to be like them. This is my goal for you. This is my aspiration for you. This is what I will help you. It used to be that way, to some extent. And that's how it needs to be again. And now it's, again, by the time people leave high school, kids, like 90% or so, just abandon the religion of their parents and abandon their religious education entirely, which means they've gotten a very poor education. I can tell you that, at least for like pointing out Catholicism and also, you know, Protestantism, Reformation Christianity, they tend to get it after a little bit more, but it's still, in general, I can make a general statement that the religious education is insufficient. The religious institutions are not providing sufficient religious education. Some of it is absurdist, actually. There's a lot of absurdity mixed into it. And I think some bright kids say, look, this is absurdist. And a lot of not-so-bright kids also say, well, I don't want to, they have an excuse. Oh, look at this stuff, silly stuff. No, it's an excuse. And the parents are simply have lost control of the younger generations in terms of insisting that they get a right education. It's the mothers that are the taskmasters. They're the ones who can insist and say, you're not getting any food. You're not, you're not going to get your dessert. You're not going to lay down the law. Let the kid realize you're absolutely serious about this, and there's no wiggle room. I mean, you can't have a man, husband say the kid's got to do it, and the mother sabotaging him, saying, don't worry, I'll talk to him. You don't really have to go. That's terrible. That's treachery. So the mother and the father have to work in tandem to raise the newer generations, and which is why I believe marriage should be arranged. Absolutely, it should be arranged by religious institutions to make sure that there's a fit, that the husband and the wife, the mother and the father, will work as a team in tandem with the children to assure the children are going to get a right religious education. So arranged marriage is super important for a good culture to function well. And the religious authorities should have a big say about that. Very big say about it. So this whole romanticism should be gotten rid of. It's ruinous. Romanticism is ruinous. Should be abolished. And the only way to really help is to help the younger generations, the new generation, the next generation, the next generation. That's how it has to go here. And the mother-father team is essential for that. And of that team, the mother is most essential. And so they, of course, were targeted here in this world by absurdity and the functionaries of absurdity. Reptilians are part of that. Certain extraterrestrial groups are part of that. They target the woman. Seduce her, subvert her. They know how to do it. And then they agree to raise their children a certain way. And that's what they're really after. And they agree to not listen to anything their husband says. If their husband disagrees, he's a sexist. He's repressive. He's holding her back. He's refusing to let her have authority to say, all this kind of weak, nonsense. Subversive nonsense. Disaster here. It's been like almost four generations now that have gone astray. And I think that once you have that many generations, that's it. The whole system collapses. The will to keep the system, to believe in the system, to make it work, collapses. And we're there's nothing holding it up anymore. So it can be easily demolished. The Pope is a demolition expert, actually. Cardinal Bergoglio is a demolition expert. He's here to demolish the church. So that data reflects an absurdist humanistic viewpoint, and the mothers can feel comfortable taking their children there and say, don't worry, you know, we'll just talk about doing good to one another, and good is, of course, buying things, gifts on Christmas, and let's not take anything too seriously about the rest of the stuff. Jesus was just a nice rabbi who wanted to social reform, so we could have everybody, all the little kiddies could have a present. See, it's not fair that just some get nice presents. We want all the little kids to have lots of materialism in their lives. So Jesus was just here, that's what we'll be saying. He was just here to make sure all you kiddies have nice birthdays and get a lot of presents, and you live a happy life because you have abundance of things, materialistic things. You make sure if you have extra, you give to others so they could also be happy with their material life. And that's what they're teaching, basically. Well, it's just an absurdity. Complete absurdity. And then, you know, the church is trying to survive. They say, well, we got to survive. We got to teach the message people want to hear. Let's teach them secular humanism. And then mothers will say, oh, yeah, that sounds like what the reptilians were telling me is going to result in my children's happiness. The reptilians are very clever. They know how to manipulate women. And, you know, they tell them, you know, they're able to tap into that desire to see their children and grandchildren be happy. And then the reptilians paint a happy picture and say, this is how they can be happy, and you can do this. And you don't want your grandchildren to be seriously studying in a monastery or as a renunciate and living a difficult life. No, you want to be a life of abundance, a nice home, nice, you know, with things and giving the charities and everything. Wow, this is, you know, you could have this. And your husband, he's just old-fashioned, you know, he's stuck in the past. When the husband says, no, you need more serious education here. There's more important principles than materialism. No, he's just a dinosaur. He's stuck in the past. And really, he's just jealous of your new voice and your new power and your new authority. And he just wants to hold you down and prevent you from being liberated, you know. And the reptilians, they harp on all this stuff continuously, and the women just, like, they get seduced by it. Lots of them flatter their vanity, flatter how much they love, you know, how their love is saving the world, saving, making the future generations, of bringing a new world order, of glorious millennium in. And on and on. There's this nonsense being promoted and marketed to women, which is designed, again, for the women to decide, how am I going to raise my children? That's the design of it all. And emphasis on my children and not my and my husband's children. And so the husband is basically out of the loop in terms of making determinations, unless he just backs up what the wife says in terms of materialistic upbringing. He's just a figurehead, is all. Someone to blame when things go wrong, too, right? Oh, yeah, got that one all worked out, too. And when it's not working out, the reptilians say, well, that's because the men are still dragging their feet. They're to blame. They're the bad guys. Blame them. And say, oh, yeah. Women say, oh, yeah, right. Right. Just, the direction's okay. It's just the men are the problem. And so you have this terrible free fall into absurdist pagan idea, belief system, culture, intent on eradicating any authority that would suggest otherwise. And, you know, another example is usury. Trying to eradicate, usury should be against the law. It should be against religious law, absolutely. You cannot charge credit, charge interest on loans. So those who are making massive amounts of money on credit and loans and interest, credit card companies, bankers, all this stuff, those people who are making, you know, just obscene, vast fortunes on usury, charging interest on loans, which a credit card's really a loan, they want to get rid of religion altogether. They want to exterminate it. Because religious people are the only ones who raise a voice, say, this is morally unjust, this is not right, we're going to ban this. This is hideous, hideous. Those who make fortunes on gambling, same thing. Those who make fortunes on speculation, same thing. All that should be illegal. But they want to the mothers to raise their children to an easy acceptance of all this stuff. That's why they want them watching television, all these things where they propagandize the children. And if the parents say, no, you cannot watch this stuff, you cannot do this, then the social services come in and take the children away. Now, my dad was very strict and wouldn't let us watch television. And he held to that. He held to a lot of positions that were very, very socially unpopular. And he got a lot of pressure for doing this. And he stuck to his guns. Eventually, it was too much for him. He had to leave. It was too much for him. He got too much pushback. He's getting too much pushback. But thank God for my dad doing that. Really. He'll receive his just praise. I'm giving him praise right now. He said, you know, this stuff is spiritually wrong. It is bad. It's corrosive. He was one of the leaders of the banning secondhand smoke, actually. He was an activist about that, too. I mean, lots of things he had the foresight. Said, this stuff is harmful. He was aware of harmful influence and says, no, you cannot do this. So he said, television, news, very harmful. He didn't let us have newspapers. He'd get periodicals. He got the Christian Science Monitor, for instance. And we'd read that for news. And so he drew the line, but he was under so much pressure. And so you can't do this, you know. And you got to back off. Let the kiddies, you know. You got to be more lenient with the kids. What's going on here? So, yeah. It's brutally difficult. Okay, brutally difficult. Brutally difficult now. And the male, I mean, that was the last of the great generation of men that had some authority. I mean, he was the final. He finally just, I can't do it anymore. I just can't do it anymore. I'm being subverted. Culture is subverting me from doing this. And he was right. So he went to India, where he still is allowed to have some authority. Still have a voice. He couldn't stand that people were demonizing him so much. And it's been several generations, I mean, since that time. Right? So, you know, the last one standing when chopped down. But because of his backbone, that was greatly helpful for me. Gave me a great start, great momentum. Like I said, some point, you know, deserves praise, and we'll see that he gets it. Super difficult. Super difficult. What he did. Somewhat of great principle, great spiritual intuition, great deal of mental clarity. And, you know, he wanted us to be enlightened. Now, he didn't understand that I was going to be enlightened because... It's like, because ultimately it's just like no practice is the answer, you know. and that was too much, you know. You couldn't quite get that one. No merit is the answer, you know. There's not a trace of merit anywhere. So the ultimate truth is something that we don't necessarily get to for a while. It's difficult. But he saw the potential. He saw that he had a lot of potential. But it just thinks that, well, maybe this guy is just, you know, he's a kook. He thought I was a little bit crazy, maybe, because I was telling him he was all wrong. I said, no, that's dualistic. That's dualistic. You don't want that. And so there's a disagreement there over what the truth was. But as far as his discipline and the help and all that stuff, outstanding, outstanding. So I get around a lot. I go to just massive amounts of places of business, and everywhere I go, is women are in charge, basically. This is who you deal with. And they assure you, they know all the answers. Whatever question you have, they know the answers. No doubt about it. This is called this false, superficial reptilian empowerment. Is just actress. Just act like you know the answers. It's entitlement complex. So basically say, you can't ask me a question that I don't know the answer to. And if you do, you're just being insolent. You're just being sexist. You're trying to undermine my authority. You know, it's like that. Is that true authority? If you ask a question that they don't know the answer to, or don't know that you're undermining their authority. Well, I mean, it's conceivable if you were just a smart aleck or something. Okay, but I'm not talking about that. I mean, you can ask all sorts of important questions that they don't know, and then they fake it. Say, well, yeah, okay. So that in their minds, they feel that they have all the answers to it, all the questions that are worth asking. And anything else isn't important. This is an absurdist attitude. This is not a guru attitude. The gurus may say, look, your questions aren't important. And will give you a higher understanding of how is this possible. Which ultimately is because there's no such thing as merit. And your questions are only compounding absurdity sort of thing. But there's a spiritual depth to this explanation. Not saying that if you have a question that I don't know the answer to, it can't be important. You know, it can't have any relevance. So that's totally different. This is what I and everybody we're talking, everyone I speak with, it's the same. This is not something that I'm just pulling out of a hat, like a rabbit out of a hat. I have canvassed the modern culture. This is what it is. And this gets passed on to the children, too. That mother knows the answer to any question that's important. And if there's no such thing as her not knowing the answer. If you ask a question he doesn't know the answer to, it's actually just a silly, stupid question. It's not relevant or important at all. So it's like, mothers are the new gurus. But are they real gurus? Are they reptilian operatives? Turning us to the reptilian brain. Materialism. Are they the new gurus? Or are they just reptilian operatives? Reptilian camouflage. Not very difficult to answer that. Not very difficult at all. If you know enough to make a discernment, right? It's that difficult. And we know that during the 70s, 80s, 90s, there was a time when women were so enthused with their contact with reptilians that they couldn't help but blab about it. And so they by the millions, and those are just ones reported, millions and millions of women were having various kinds of relationships with reptilians. Subtle, on the psychic level, psychophysical, psychosexual, all these relationships. They're having relationships. They were in love with reptilians. They're having these adulterous relationships with reptilians. Adulteresses, plain and simple. Oh, but it's okay, you don't know. What about your husband? Oh, well, this is kind of, you know, this is something different, you know. There's something on the side, you know. Well, these poor reptilians, you know, they're more supportive of me, you know. More supportive of my materialistic vanity is what it should be said. So this is just what was reported by some spoke up about it and said that this is what they're doing. And they were like proud of it, you know. It's like, until the rep, you know, they realized Reptilian said, hey, you know, better shut up about it. And then it just like never happened, you know. Most people don't realize it, but it was like 30 years or so. This was coming out more and more and more and more and more in books and publications and testimonies, etc. And this was just the tip of the iceberg. And this has continued to be going on. Many of them had children, hybrid children, and with reptilians, and had the ovum, their eggs, inseminated artificially, and on and on and on, to bring about this new root race, you know, this new race of happy. Happy people, happy, you'll have happy children. They're going to liberate the world from this old, terrible male patriarchal domination. You know, this is the reptilian spiel, all this stuff about how terrible patriarchs, you know, patriarch society, all this nonsense is, that's reptilian lies, okay? Because it's never been like the way they've portrayed it, actually. It was more a balance of a power, it was more of a team. I mean, the women wanted good religious education for their children as much or more than the men. So they insisted, hey, men, be tough, back me up. And if I get weak, you know, which the children can undermine me, right? You know, mom gets tired, children undermines her. I want you to come in there and say, no, I won't break. I'll bend, but I won't break. You must stay strong. And the reptilians said, oh yeah, the men, they're so terrible. You know, they're all just awful. They don't really know what's, they don't want to work hard. They're just lazy. If they really, you know, cared about you, they'd be better providers with all the stuff you want. And they, you know, get you all the credit cards you want. They wouldn't be scared about credit. What is this nonsense? They, you know, let you gamble, let you get contraceptives, let you have affairs, you know, let you liberate it, enjoy the body, and they allow you to drink and take drugs and, you know, all this stuff. Oh, no, they're just, you know, want it all for themselves. This is propaganda from reptilian propaganda, has been from the very beginning. That's why a lot of wise women said, wait a minute, you know, this is misrepresentation. This wasn't how things really have been going on. No, we've had a lot of power. Are you kidding me? And it's teamwork, and we understand sometimes the children undermine us, and we need help. So it's been a grotesque demonization, propagandic demonization of men. And their right of authority. And this is what my dad was up against. And he really cared about trying to help others on the spiritual path. So it was devastating to him. And he traveled around the world trying to find some place where he had some authority. And ultimately, at the end, he just said, I can't find it. It's not out there. It's not out there. It's gone. And I said, yeah, I believe you. That's what's foretold. This is how it's going to go. But for him, that was the end. You know, he couldn't express his authority, so he ended up getting cancer over it, really. I tried to help him by saying, look, one of the ways that we can be helped is accept some female authority, but that's a true guru, though. True liberated sage, like Ananda Mahima, for instance, that can help you out. It shall help reestablish your voice and authority. And it did help him. I had some holy water that had been blessed by the kirtan of Ananda Mahima, which I had going 24 hours a day. And I just gave him this bottle of water, and I said, look, this has her charged with her grace, the grace that she was bringing through. I said, just drink this. He at that point, he was about ready to die. He couldn't drink anything. He couldn't eat or drink anything. His throat was completely blocked with cancer. He staggered into the house after being gone for 30 years or more, whatever. And I said, just drink it. Drink it. It's going to help you. He drank that. He drank this holy water. He had the courage to do that, the faith to do that. In 3 days, he was eating and drinking normally. In fact, eating vast quantities of food and enjoying, like an Epicurean. The cancer just shrunk away. It shrunk into a small little area. And it just stayed there in a small little area. And the mistake he made, well, the mistake that he got pressured into was that he then tried to get rid of the rest of the cancer there. And he wasn't ready for that. He didn't. That rest of that cancer represented his challenge left on the path to see further. And I told him, just live with it. I said, look, it's in remission. Just live with it. It might come back at some point. Maybe it won't. But just stay in the grace, God's grace, and live with that. And he got pressured by a lot of people, put him under pressure that he had to eradicate it because they were using him as a figurehead. The women were using him as a figurehead to disguise their own naked power lust, you know. They were propping up, saying, no, he's the one who's the authority. But he was just, you know, they were controlling him, trying to control him. And they're the ones that crucified him, actually. And so he tried to get rid of it per their requests and demands. And then he told me he was under terrible pressure to put up with this facade of perfection. And he felt he had no choice. He couldn't resist it. So they crucified him. Crucified my dad. The women crucified my dad. No question about it. And Ananda, my ma, her grace shrunk the tumor in 3 days from some hideous to just a small, something that didn't affect or bother him at all. And she was not against male authority at all. In fact, she supported it. She said it's super important. Men have to have a strong voice to back up the women with the children and the raising right religious education for their children. Super important. So she supported all the male institutions of God's grace here that happen to have men supporting them, and she supported the women too to do that also. And has supported me along with the other teachers I have, which are all just an expression of the Holy Spirit, to refine my voice, which was crushed. It was crushed. My voice was so bad that if I was like trying to talk with a matriarchal representative, my voice was like a whisper, a ghost, and then it would disappear. I was so frightened, intimidated, and under repression. You talk about sexist repression. Matriarchy wants the men to have no voice. You know, that's what sexist repression is, but it's ultimately absurdity. I didn't have a voice at all. Couldn't speak. Couldn't even speak. I just had to sit in silence because I couldn't say anything. Gradually, I learned about Ananda Maima's life. I said, hey, I need to speak up about this. This is super important. And so I started trying to speak up, tried to give people materials about it. I tried to teach them about it. I said, look, this is an uber saint here. This is a mega saint. This is a colossal mega saint. And it makes no difference if she's female or male to me. This is a colossal mega saint. And we need to pay attention to this. This is super helpful. And so I tried to teach people. That got nowhere. They just ignored me. They thought I was crazy. They ignored me. Really. But in the effort to do so, I began to recover my voice. Same with A Course in Miracles. I said, A Course in Miracles, this is uber book, uber teaching, super important, mega super important teaching. And so I started taping my experiences with A Course in Miracles and the insight I was getting. I started taping it in my room. And gradually, this is how I recovered my voice that had been basically virtually destroyed. That is correct, virtually destroyed. My voice, I couldn't even speak hardly. It was just a soft whisper. And I started trying to talk, trying to stand up to the matriarchy. Literally, my voice would stop. I couldn't say anything. I'd have to leave. You know, this is how bad it was. Only the grace of God is responsible for the fact that I'm able to speak up now in this way. That's it. It's no thanks to the matriarchy at all. And Ananda Maya Ma is not part of the feminist matriarchy, is not part of that at all. Thank God for that. fact that she would show up like she did yesterday for me, after everything that I've said, and to help me, vastly help me, should give you an indication that she is quite pleased I'm able to speak up like this. Doesn't mean everything I say is completely spot on, 100% spot on, but it's getting better and better and better. It's getting very good. When you talk about there's not even a trace of merit anywhere to be found, and never will be, this is high teaching. This is the kind of teaching that these teachers love to hear. This is what they want to get us to, the point where we can enunciate this, we can say this. Interesting. I just saw a car with this decal I've never seen before. It was an orange Christian cross, and in the middle of the cross was a crescent moon with a star or something. It looked like, I think, a symbol of Islam. And a Christian Muslim, I guess. Okay. Yeah, that's an Abrahamic religion. Brother religions, really. All religions are one, actually. They're all pointing to the same truth, salvation through grace, ultimately. Sure, they've been distorted. Our attempts to subvert them by absurdity in this world. Of course, that's why you need those that could keep coming in the world to refresh, 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 keep it fresh. Take out the garbage. You know, there's a lot of garbage if it has accumulated. That's what I've done in my life. I've taken out garbage from everybody's house. Take out garbage if you want. I'm willing to roll up my sleeves and get the garbage out, get the junk out, get the gunk out. You know, nothing intimidates me as far as nasty gunk. And God knows this world is, the pipes of this world are clogged with nasty gunk, and the sewer is backing up in everybody's homes. And the backing up of the sewer in everybody's homes is called television. It's called the internet. It's called the smartphone. This is just the backing up of the sewage system here, pouring into our homes. And the homemakers, the women are saying, oh, this is nice. Maybe I can accessorize this with some new tile or something. Hey, kiddies, isn't this cool? And some of the kids are saying, actually, no. Oh, really? It's bothering you? Okay. Let me take the doctor. I'll get you on some anti-anxiety medication. You're suffering from some sort of syndrome. You don't think this is cool. You don't think that I'm always right. That's okay. We got medication for that. No worries. Now, Jewish, I've always had a lot of Jewish people like me because they're used in their tradition to listening to some rabbi who was not afraid to speak the truth to them, right? That's true. And some Protestants like me also. Same reason, they have a pastor who's not afraid to speak the truth. And some Catholics like me, they have a priest who's not afraid to speak the truth. They're used to hearing someone who has a voice of authority telling them what they need to hear, which maybe their mom won't tell them. Maybe, you know, the mom says, well, I don't want the kids to think I'm too strict. So, you know, let's go take you to the priest or rabbi or your pastor or, you know, imam or something, you know, the guru, whatever, the lama, and let them do it. Because I don't want the kids thinking that mommy is, you know, terrible here, too strict. This is a way for mothers, you know, to get along with their children. And they say, respect these authority figures because they're telling you the truth. And I have a hard time. I gotta put up with all your tantrums and stuff. And so they're helping me out. They're helping me out. You see how religious authority helps women out. It helps women out do the right thing with their children. Vastly helpful for them. And we leave it all up to mom. She capitulates. I mean, kids are devious, you know? They're relentless. Mothers are worn out. Okay, go ahead and watch TV. Okay, you want to play this video game? Okay, yeah, go, just leave me alone. I mean, just, you know, kids are just brutal. They've got so much energy. You got all these kids running around constantly. I mean, it's a brutally tough job to be a mother. And they need the help of religious authority. And they need the help of their husbands, and they need their husbands to have authority. And they need the law to back this up. And none of that's happening right now. It's all the opposite of that. And so the pharmaceutical companies come in and say, don't worry, mom. We have what you really need and wanted and needed all along. That other stuff, it's archaic. Yeah. That was just because we didn't have these medications. That's why. You don't need the priest or the pastor or the rabbi or the imam anymore. The guru. No, come on. The lama. Come on. That's old-fashioned stuff. But now we've really cracked the secret of materiality, cracked the secret of these compounds, and we're able to control the brain chemistry of your children just fine. And so you live in a blessed age, mom. I mean, wow, congratulations, mom, for being a modern woman in a blessed age with blessed children, that you have the tools now to really educate them properly. And they won't bother you anymore, though. Everybody will be happy. And mom says, wow, just, okay, you know, whatever works. Sometimes I just can't handle it sometimes. Pharmaceutical. Don't worry, Bob, you get stressed out by capitulating like this. You feel guilty. We have medications for that, too. We have these compounds. When you feel guilty, like maybe you're not doing the right thing by your children, say, don't worry about that. We got lots of compounds to treat whatever it is that's bothering you. Having friction with your husband, get rid of your husband. Feel bad about that? I got compounds for that too. Whatever it is, whatever trouble is, we have plenty of compounds to help you. Insurance to pay for them. I mean, this is just like nirvana, right? Utopia. So the rabbis, you know, were. You know, they didn't hold back. They were tight. They would not hold back, the good ones. They said, look, this is how it is, to the best of their ability. But they had the authority to speak up. And the kids were taught to respect that. And we're speaking in generalities to make a point here. But now in this youth culture, whatever the kids want, you know, that's fine. That's great. They know best. They want more chocolate. Give them more chocolate. We got a tummy ache? Give them some medicine. Give them all these vaccines. Let's give them a whole bunch of vaccines about stuff that might happen. You know, we think, maybe the Spanish flu will come back. Let's get a vaccine for that and vaccinate them for that ahead of time. All these potential illnesses, let's vaccinate them all for that. Don't worry about side effects, come on. We got a vaccination for side effects too. A lot of money in vaccinations, isn't there? A lot of money in medications, isn't there? A lot of greed. A lot of vast wealth being made through credit cards and vaccinations and medications and gambling and on and on. Speculation. Somebody's getting fabulously wealthy. And the wives, our wives and girlfriends, etc., and relatives and mothers and grandmothers of these wealthy, vastly rich people, they're getting pampered. They're getting supremely pampered. And they like that. And the stockholders are getting vastly wealthy. And they're getting pampered too. And they love that. They care more about their pampering and their vanity than they do your children. By a long shot. They're sacrificing the lives of your children so they can to satisfy their vanity. And telling you that you're liberated because you go along with it. So I'm ecumenical. Maybe I'm a modern day rabbi, priest, pastor, imam, lama, guru, so to speak, like that. Only difference is not many are listening because we're told, no, you can't listen to that anymore. That's archaic. We have these compounds now. You don't need that stuff. That stuff is difficult. You know, this is easier to take a pill, isn't it? I don't take pills. Right? That's a bad habit. It's so easy. Just pop a pill. Oh, I feel relaxed now. Ask the Holy Spirit to send all your afflictions into a future life that you may or may not exercise that option. You might exercise the option of a future life. You say, so I'll struggle with suffering and sickness and merit, all this stuff in a future life if need be. This one, let me feel perfect. This is extremely helpful advice here as far as sickness and illness and troubles go. Send it all into a future life. Now, people used to try to use, they still do, use Jesus, but they didn't quite do it in the right way. They said that the merit of Jesus was so strong that even he had all these afflictions, that his merit with God was so pleased with the merit of Jesus that God would forgive, that his merit paid for all the sins that we put onto Jesus, and he could pay for all our sins to God. See, this is how they believe it. This is, none of that's true at all, because there's no such thing as merit. It's a magical belief. But the principle of, like, there's some way to get rid of our suffering. How you really do it, tell the Holy Spirit, okay, and tell yourself this, just, okay, I'm not going to entertain any of this suffering this life. For the rest of this life, it's going to be completely free of all suffering. I'm going to be in bliss, as a matter of fact. And all this stuff about merit and then suffering and illnesses and the challenge of that and maybe taking medications and everything. Just, I'm going to put all that onto a future life. And I'll deal with it then if I decide to have a future life okay, of that type. But it will all be in a future life, not this one. I've had many afflictions vanish that way. Vanish. I say it doesn't matter how Holy Spirit how you make it vanish. It's just put it into a future life. That's just not now. Not now. So put it into time, just not now. Okay, for the rest of this life, it's just gonna I'm gonna dwell in now. And if I choose to dwell in time, then we'll deal with the problems of time at that point. Alright? This is the key. Don't try to get rid of it ultimately. This is what I told my dad. The cancer shrug. It was almost gone. I said, live with it now. Okay. Which means that you still have the potential to entertain cancer at some other point in the future. Just not in this life. In another life. Unfortunately, I didn't express it to him that clearly. If I did, I probably would have gone along with it. I don't know. He was under severe pressure from the matriarchy. But he may have. He may have got along with that. So I'm saying this advice to him right now. And everybody. Everybody used this. So don't try to completely eradicate the potentiality to engage with absurdity, time, sickness, all these troubles. Don't try to eradicate it. Just say, you know, for the rest of this life, it's not going to have any effect on me whatsoever. So my dad could have just lived with this sort of cancer and remissionness for the rest of his life, for a long time. He'd still be here, probably. And that way you say, you know what, I'm still kind of in touch with it a little bit, and if I want to go back and get full-blast cancer, I'll do it in another life, not this one. So use it. Use it. It's free. It's free. Free advice. Do you think that the pharmaceutical companies and want you to follow this advice? Materialistic structure. Follow it anyway. Say, they don't like it. I'll deal with them not liking that in a future life. In this life, I'm free of pressure and trouble. I'm in bliss. Nobody can do anything about it. If I'm going to experience them trying to do something about it, it'll be in a future life. That's all. A time-based life. You know, if I'm going to have a time-based life, it's going to be in the future, not now. That's one way to put it, right? Okay, very great. We're just absolutely full blast here, as always. Rabbi Ross. That's right, Rabbi Ross. Bringing the heat. I was a pitcher. I loved the pitch. I had a great fastball. Awesome fastball. Couldn't even see it. There's a saying, you can't hit what you can't see. So that's absolutely said, you know, here it comes and there it goes, and what, you know, what happened? Got to bring the heat. You got to bring the fastball here, the high heat, the cheese. You know, good morning, good afternoon, good night. That's how it's got to go. Just pump the gas. 100 plus. Just sit them down. Just like that. So that's what we do. We don't fool around. We don't throw a bunch of junk up there. You know, we're not junk ballers. We're you know, high heat, high fastballs. Boom, boom, boom. That's it. Put it in the future, not this life. Rest this life, absolute bliss. Massive miracles. You want me to have a non-miraculous life? Next lifetime, maybe I'll have a non-miraculous, or some lifetime in the future, way down the road, maybe I'll have a non-miraculous life. That's possible. That's possible. You know, don't try to eradicate the possibility. Because we are free. We're free. We're free. We could do whatever we want to do. And if we want to have a non-miraculous life, it's a boy experiencing. Well, of course, we're free to do so. So that's also just express your freedom in that way. Yeah. But just not this life. Because I choose to live a miraculous life right now. All right. Very great. That's it.